God, we thank you for this beautiful morning, and we thank you for your presence in our lives. God, we glorify you and lift you up today, and I just pray that you'll bring refreshing and that your presence will fall in this place today. In Jesus' name, amen.
God who was, we worship the God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the doors, he parted the raging seas. My God, he holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord, our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. We sing to the God who was, we sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung upon that cross and he rose up from that grave. My God, still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
We were
the beggars. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. Now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. We'll sing, we were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. Shout out your praise.
Jesus, boy, there is joy in the house of the Lord this morning. Wow, praise the Lord. Restrictions are coming off and freedom is coming. Hallelujah. Bonnie, come on up.
Hallelujah, there's joy in the house of the Lord. Isn't that awesome that we get to be here this morning? Well, Saturday night, we're going to have another night of prayer where we're going to pray for our leadership. We're going to continue to pray for unity in our body, for healing and restoration. Come and be a part of it. We were set forth with a challenge yesterday. Will we sit in our chairs and remain quiet? or will we get up and will we move? One way we can move is through prayer. So come and join us next Saturday night, this coming Saturday night at 7 p.m. I can't wait.
Amen. Praise the Lord. God is on the move. We're so grateful to have Bill and Tammy. They'll be speaking to us this morning. If you've been here this weekend, it's been a powerful weekend. We're so grateful for what God does through them. There will be a water baptism March 27th. If you're interested in getting water baptized, please call the office. And we can only do so many at a time because of our, but we'll keep doing it. And next week I'll be teaching on water baptism. And great to be together. Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Let's worship the Lord.
How my heart leaps, how my soul
Jesus, we praise you for all that you've done. We praise you for all the wonderful ways that you've provided for us, God. We praise you for your grace and your mercy in our lives, God. We pray that you will just continue to move, God. We pray for revival in our city, for revival in our church, for all the churches that glorify the name of Jesus in this city, God. We pray that your holy anointing will fall upon them, upon their leadership, Lord. And we pray, God, that you will get all the glory, that you will get all the honor and all the praise. Jesus, we focus on you this morning. We look to you for every answer that we could ever need. We love you, Lord. Oh, how high would I climb mountains if the mountains were where you hide? Oh, how far I'd scale the valleys if you graced the other side. Oh, how long have I chased rivers from lowly seas to where they rise? Against the rush of grace descending from the source of its supply. In the highlands and the heartache, you're neither more or less inclined. I would search and stop at nothing. You're just not that hard to find. Thank you, Lord. I will praise you on the mountain. I will praise you in the mountains in my way. You're the summit where my feet are. So I'll praise you in the valleys all the same. No less God within the shadows, no less faithful when the night leads me astray. You're the heaven where my heart is. In the highlands, in the heartache, all the same. Extend the path where you feed on sunrise to where you sweep the sinners past. Oh, how fast would you come running if just to shadow me through the night? Trace the steps through all my failures and walk me through other side. For who would dare ascend that mountain, that valleyed hill called Calvary? Before the one I call Good Shepherd, who like a lamb was slain for me. Hallelujah. I will praise you on the mountain. So I'll praise you in the valleys all the same. No less God within the shadows. No less faithful when the night leads me astray. You're the heaven where my heart is. In the highlands and the heartache all the same. Whoa.
deep but empty grave. I will praise you on the mountain. I will praise you in the mountains in my way. You're the summit where my feet are. So I'll praise you in the valleys all the same. No less God within the shadows. No less faithful when the night leads me astray. You're the heaven where my heart is. In the highlands and the heartache all the same.
Yes, Lord, you are there in the good and in the bad and in the highs and the lows. We can always rely on you, Jesus. God, I just pray for anyone who feels like you've been far away, Lord. Just pray that you'll show up afresh. That they'll be able to recognize your voice, God. We sing to you.
Who else would rocks cry out to worship? Whose glory taught the stars to shine? Perhaps creation longs to have the words to sing. But this door Jesus, this song is forever yours. A thousand hallelujahs and a thousand more. Who else would die for our redemption? Whose resurrection means our rise? There is all you've done, but I have eternity to try. With a thousand hallelujahs, we magnify your name. You alone deserve the glory, the honor, and the praise. Lord Jesus, this song is forever yours. A thousand hallelujahs and a thousand more. We worship Jesus today. We give it all to you, Lord. Ooh. Praise to the Lord, to the Lord. Jesus, this song is forever yours. A thousand hallelujahs and a thousand more.
Hallelujah. Thank you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hermanos. Hermanos. It's great to be here again. We've had a great time the last couple of days for you, those that you were here and those that were watching. And well, we're just trusting and know that God is with us. For those of you who don't know us, my name's Bill. My wife, Tammy. We've been missionaries for 30-some-odd years, which doesn't make us any more special than anyone else here. We're just serving the Lord somewhere else. We're obeying what God told us to do, and that's what we're doing. And so we've come to encourage you. We've come to challenge you. We've come to make you uncomfortable in a good way. Because we really want to see you walk your faith out in a way that your testimony will be so much bigger than some of the biggest testimonies we've ever read about. Because the same Jesus that lives in you is the same Jesus that did it through them. So if I could just pray, let's just get started, okay? Thank you, Jesus. We love you. There aren't words to express how much we love you and how much we want to serve you. Father God, we pray and we know that you're here with us and that your presence, Holy Spirit, would be manifested in this place in a way, God, that's tangible, in a way that touches the deep parts of those that are listening and those that are receiving. Father God, your word is sharper than a two-edged sword, and we pray that that surgery will be done on the hearts that need to hear it. Holy Spirit, we give you full reign. We ask you to plant in our minds your thoughts so that we could be changed in the image of Christ. I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, I was, we were married in the 80s. But back then there was a singer named Keith Green that was really popular. And he was pretty radical, came out of the Jesus People movement. And I remember there was a phrase that he, just before he died, because he died in a plane crash with some of his kids. But he was focused on missions. He had done a missions trip to Africa, and it impacted his life. And so he began to talk about going. And I remember one of the phrases he said was, you know, the scripture says, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. He says, if God hasn't given you permission to stay, he already told you to go. And that's true today. It hasn't changed. The command is go. Now, we get panicky when we think that that means going to the other side of the world or going to somewhere unknown where it's uncomfortable that we can't, it'll be hard. But going is going. You know, there was a guy named Arthur Blessed that traveled all over the world carrying a cross. And amazing stories. But he was preaching one day and he said about obeying God. He says, if God has spoken to you to go to Africa, then you need to find the resources and go. He says, and if you can't get on a plane, then get on a bus. He says, and if you can't get on a bus, get in a car. And if you can't get in a car, take a bike. And if you can't take a bike, just lean and fall in the direction that God is calling you, but do something. And that is going. I know people that have come to visit us in Mexico. A long time ago, there was a couple from Detroit, and the husband says, he was just excited about being there. He said, God spoke to me like 2 years ago to learn Spanish. And so we asked him, so have you learned Spanish? Well, no, uh-huh. So you do that with all of God's words. And how flippantly we say that God spoke to me and we don't do it. The weight of God's words seem to not have that same weight. But when God speaks, my responsibility is to obey. My responsibility is to act. If he said go, I don't need to question if I'm supposed to go. I need to question where. Is it to my neighbor? Is it to my fellow worker? Is it in the city? Is it Toronto? Where, God, where do you want me to go? Because you've already said go. He said, well, I'm not prepared. I don't know. Gee. I'm going to tell you a story, and I've used this story 100 times or more. During the Great Depression, there was a man named Yates who owned a huge ranch in Texas. And, I mean, it was monstrous, the ranch. I don't know, thousands and thousands of acres. So before the Depression, he was a man of means. He had lots of money. The Depression hit. He had no way to sustain his family. So he was about to sell his ranch when a big oil company came and they said, we've been doing some investigating and we want to see if there's oil on your property. We'll pay you, you know, the rights to be able to check. And he's going, well, there's some income. Let's do that. So within a matter of months, they found one of the largest deposits of oil in all of North America. And he became a very, very wealthy man. But my question is, the wealth was already there. The problem is he had never tapped into it. He had never reaped the benefits of it until this company came and showed him what he actually had. The scripture says, know the truth and the truth will make you free. So we have to think conversely. Believe a lie and the lie will make you a slave. If you've been bound by unbelief and you're not doing what God has spoken to you, then you really don't know the resources that he's deposited in you. You don't know that deposit of the kingdom of God that is there waiting for you to access it. But because of doubt and unbelief, we're frozen and we don't act. That's why I said we're not special. We're not special. We make mistakes. We've made lots of mistakes, but at least we're making mistakes in the doing. And I want to say we're not special. We're just like you. We disagree. I don't wake up in the morning and adjust my halo. You know, I put my shoes on the same way. So we've got to eliminate this idea of famous Christians and quit looking up to men because they'll always fall off their pedestal. We've got to look up to Jesus and fill ourselves with truth. By knowing the truth, we'll become free and understand who we are and what he's deposited in us. I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, not I will be. Greater is he that is in me now than he that is in the world. And sometimes he's not even talking about Satan. Who's in the world but my flesh? My flesh is probably one of the biggest enemies I have. Hiding a bushel would be like hiding that which is precious over, cover it with carnal stuff. You know, don't hide it under. God wants to just pull it out into the light and just show you what he can do through you. And again, this is not about works. You know, because sometimes, well, yeah, God's calling me to work. No, he's calling you to enjoy. This is an exciting life. To watch somebody, I remember Kevin. Is Kevin here? Where are you, Kevin? Kevin lived with us for quite a few years when we first started the work. And I remember on one occasion, we went to pray for a young man who was dying of AIDS. And this man was dying. I mean, there was no hope. We're talking Arriaga, Chiapas, which is a small town away from the city. There's no real good medical access. And he was at home. And his father calls and says, could you please pray for my son? So we loaded up him and Jonathan and myself, and we went to this guy's little house, and there he was, skin and bones, laying on this bed. You might complain about your posturpedic mattress. His was ropes tied together with a blanket over the top. That was his bed. And he was like a skin and bones. So we just gathered around him, and I'm thinking, Lord, what do we do? I mean, the first thing the enemy wants to make you think is there are actually diseases that are a challenge for God. cancer, oh, maybe. Let's just bless them and send them on their way. Or AIDS, we think, well, AIDS is just, I don't know, God. It's not about whether he can. Do we believe he can? And is that what he's doing right then? So I didn't know what to do. I was thinking, what am I going to say, Lord? I thought, I'm just going to sing in the Spirit. And so Kevin and Jonathan and I, we just began to pray over him and just begin to sing in tongues. And all of a sudden, there was movement under his t-shirt here, under his skin. And it began to go up. The more we sang, the more we worshiped, it went up and up and up. And then all of a sudden, he began to choke. Well, when he began to choke, then we began to take authority. And we commanded that thing to leave. He threw up in the bed. I've never seen anything like it. He was completely healed. But who did that? Who did that? The Spirit of the Lord, who dwells in me, began to move in the atmosphere. The power that was released by singing in the Spirit began to make things happen. I didn't have to know what was next. I just had to know who was in the room. And that he's trustworthy. How many of you are born again? Let me see your hands. Don't be ashamed. Let's see. How many of you are born again? Okay. Christ in you is the hope of glory. You have what you need. You have the deposit of Christ in you. The problem is you don't believe it. You'll read it. You'll believe it. You'll acquiesce to it. And I'm not saying everybody. But there comes a moment where you have to say, Lord, I need to understand who I am to be able to do what you're calling me to do. If you're calling me to go, Lord, please show me. I don't want it to just be weak words that I confess and I hope that this will make it so. And so I want to tell you, it says in Ephesians that Jesus was raised to sit at the right hand of the Father, far above all principalities and powers and mights and all of darkness. But I'm going to tell you something. If we go to Ephesians 2, 4 through 8, it says, but God, being rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, okay, there's the motive, even when we were dead in our transgressions, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you've been saved. And raised us up with him and seated us where? With him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So that in the age to come, he might show the surpassing riches of his grace in kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you've been saved through faith, that not of yourself. It's a gift of God. So it says that God raised Jesus from the dead and seated him at his right hand with authority and power and dominion. The powers of the age to come in Christ are now available to his body right now. So when we see someone healed, it's because we are seated with Christ. And the powers that are coming when he returns are active in us now. It's not about us. It's about obeying. It's about saying, Lord, what do you want to do today? What is your will for me today? How many times do we say, I gave my life to Jesus? When really we're saying, I gave a percentage of my life to Jesus. The rest is mine. We can't tithe what we've given to Jesus. We gave it all, and he expects it all, and he wants it all. He desires it all. He's anxious for it all. That surrender that my wife was talking about. So the healing of that young man was a manifestation of the power that's coming in the now. And that is the Christ that lives in you. Being born again is not about missing hell. Being born again is not about getting heaven. It's about eternal life. And the minute we walk through that door which is Jesus, we have walked into eternal life because he said, this is eternal life, that you know the Father and his Son whom he sent. You have entered into eternal life. You've got it. We're not like a dog who's chasing his tail, trying to get what he already has. We've got it. But what do we do with it? There's a world out there, brothers. Last night, I woke up at 2:30, and the Lord was just speaking to me. And because we've been talking about missions, and you know, he calls us to go. And the phrase was, go so that they will come. We don't just go to do the work on his behalf. We go so that they will come. Jesus went to Mary's house, and Mary came to his feet. Jesus went to Lazarus' tomb, and Lazarus came forth. When we go, Jesus is doing something. He's calling people to himself. And he's doing it in ways that you could never imagine nor be prepared for. Because he is a spirit. He's supernatural. He's multidimensional. He's God. And he can do what he wants to available with available vessels. Are you hungry for that? Do you want that? You see, the problem is we've converted church into a big therapy session. We come and want to, I just want Jesus to touch me. We sing about us and what I've gone through. There was a song in Mexico, I quit singing it because it actually sounded like a dirge. And you say, and all the words were like, I've passed through a river, I'm drowning in pain. I think, oh yeah, hallelujah. I was in an event just recently where most of the music was about us, you know, and how wonderful I am, and we're going to praise, and we're going to do this, and we're going to do that. And then all of a sudden, there was a song, and it was all about Jesus. You could have felt the Holy Spirit get excited in the room. He loves that. If you want to see or experience the Holy Spirit energize the room, begin to worship Jesus. I mean, directly. Not about him. Worship him. And the Holy Spirit's right there. Because it's his greatest joy to glorify Jesus. Are you with me? Amen. It's time to change our perspective. You see, we've had the concept. We come to church. We get fixed. We go home. We have some struggles. We can get through the week. We're going to go back and get our refill. And we're going to come. No. We are filled. Sometimes we're leaky. We need to plug the leaks. But a lot of it's what you're believing. What are you believing? Why are you bound up? Why are you struggling? Why are you doubting? Go to the Word and find out what the Word says. Knowing the truth will set you free. But that's not acquiescing to the truth. It's knowing it. I believe, and you know what? Freedom comes. Freedom comes. So we need to change our perspective. We have this concept that it's kneeling down to pray is a great act of honor before God. But sometimes in our mind, we have the idea that this is my position before God, and I'm praying up through the heavens, hoping that God will come down and do what I need him to do. So we have this perspective, please, Jesus. And if I pray hard enough, which I'm not sure what that looks like. I really prayed hard today. Twisting Jesus' arms. But we're praying up, hoping that we can get him to come out. Send your angels. Jesus is here. He's right here. He's among us. He's walking with us. His Holy Spirit is here. We don't ask him to come on a taxi and show up. We need him. He's here. Our perspective, it says we're seated in heavenly places. So we're not looking up, hoping him to come down. We're with him, believing that he's sending and doing and working. And so we're in agreement with Jesus. With what he's doing. We're agreeing with what he's doing in open doors. We're not saying, oh God, please, could you just do something? No, he said, I'm doing something. Are you in agreement? Amen. Put your seatbelt on. Jesus is moving. Amen. Hallelujah. The last thing before my wife comes up and we do the handoff. Faith, the word says your faith is more precious than gold. Satan does not want your house. He doesn't want your family. He doesn't want your possessions. But he will use every one of those to destroy your faith. He will. He will use everything to destroy your faith. He will use bitterness and unbelief. He will use ruptured relationships. He will use theft. He will use whatever to shake your faith. Because that is the thing that ignites the world for Jesus. When you believe and work together with the Holy Spirit, things happen. And if the enemy can shake your faith, he will. He'll try. So how do we grow in faith? Well, I think growing in faith is hearing the Lord and doing what he tells you to do and watching him move. Every time I've seen someone healed, you know what's happened to my faith? Makes me want to pray for more people. And you know what? Even when I don't see healing, I want to pray for more people because I know he wants to heal. It's his nature. It says he went about doing good and healing all those who were oppressed of the devil. Do you think he's changed his mind about that? Do you think he's okay with leaving a few oppressed of the devil? Oh yeah, just that's good for them. Just let them have it. No. The same Christ that walked the earth, that set those people free, is the same Christ who lives in you and is calling you to do the same thing. There are a lot of captives out there. But we have to change our perspective. We have to realize that deposit of Christ who's in us and where we are seated. Do you know that? Do you know that? I want to challenge you. No one can convince you. No one can show you except Jesus. And you're going to find it in his word. You want to come up? Later, when she's done, last night at about, well, maybe I'll give it to you now. Come on. I had two things come in my mind. I wrote them down that I felt like they were words of knowledge. And like I told everyone last night, or when we talk about words of knowledge, you know, we miss it. You know, you're okay to say, what was that? You know, I never want to fake it to make it. But last night I woke up and I saw the word, and I could spell it I-N-U-I-T, I-N-U-I-T. And I thought, wow, what is that? And so in the morning I got up and I searched it out, and it was some indigenous group here in Canada. How do you say it? Inuit? Inuit. And I felt like the Lord was saying there's an individual whose parents or grandparents, she was from this group and the father was European. And this individual has struggled most of their life with identity issues, trying to find out, who am I? And so they've sought, you know, let me check out my European roots or my indigenous roots. And the Lord is saying, none of that will help you. Because you have a new identity in me. You have a new nation. And so whoever this is, whether it's online or here, you need to know that the Lord, when you gave your heart to Jesus, he made you of a new tribe, and your identity is in Christ. Another one was, and I don't know if the name Steve went with this word or if it was separate, but I got the name Steve. And then I saw the name Beth or Bethany. And I saw Beth, I'll just say Beth because Bethany, I couldn't distinguish. She was holding an empty baby blanket. And at first I was looking and saying, Lord, what is this? And I felt like this had to do with the loss of a child. And this is what the Lord said to me. Your grief is no longer a part of the healthy process of healing, my daughter. but a tool of the enemy to keep you from being the catalyst that I've designed you to be. We understand that there aren't words to explain when someone has lost a loved one, but there's a moment when grief becomes a tool of the enemy and is no longer healthy. And I felt that was the situation with this young woman. Maybe she lost a baby, maybe she had a miscarriage or something. I don't know. But if that's somebody watching me, the Lord is saying, it's time. It's time. Because I've designed you to be a catalyst for change in others' lives, and the enemy is stopping you with your pain. Can we just pray for that person? Father, such deep sadness that overwhelms in waves because of the loss. But I know, Lord Jesus, that you have a calling on this individual and that you want to revive them, rescue them, and cause them to be that catalyst. I just speak blessing right now, and I speak deliverance over them in Jesus' name, and that the enemy that's held them captive with grief will be bound right now, and that they will be free because they are your, she's your daughter, Lord. Bless her, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. I have a scripture that is on my heart, and I'm just going to read this to you out of Isaiah 55, verse 6. Seek ye Jehovah while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. And let him return unto Jehovah, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, and neither are your ways my ways, saith Jehovah. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. And that scripture came to me this morning because so many times when God doesn't work the way that we expect him to work, we want to give up. We want to throw in the towel. He's not moving the way I thought. He's not answering me the way I thought. And we get so discouraged. And I just want to remind you, he's God and we're not. He has the right to move in our lives the way he chooses. God has always been faithful to answer my prayers, but it's not in the way a lot of times that I thought. And I had several things that came to my mind this morning as we were just preparing our hearts. And one of them was this. It was something that had happened in Detroit many years ago before we were on the mission field. And I was driving down the road, and there was, and I'm not sure what it's called, Asheville, but it's not a retirement center, and it's not a residential home or something for older people. But it was like, it was on the outside, it was so depressing. And as I drove by it, I felt the Lord say, go in. And I'm thinking, was that God? Was that the Lord? And a few days later, I drove by again, and I felt like the Lord said, I need you to go in there. And so I just stopped and I went in, and I didn't even know what I was going to say to anybody, and I didn't know anybody in there. And the woman that answered the door, I said, is there something that I can do? Can I volunteer? Is there anything that you would need that I might could do? And she said, well, we need somebody to kind of help with art. Well, my background was art. And I said, I can do art projects or crafts or something. I could do something. She said, okay, well, you could volunteer two or three times a week if you wanted to. And I still walked away thinking, God, why am I here? What am I supposed to do? And so the following week, I went in and I started giving a little art project. And it was a sad place. The walls were kind of an army color green, and the people were depressed, and people, they weren't being taken care of really well. Many of the residents were sitting in wheelchairs, and they had either defecated on themselves, or it was a terrible place. And I would sit there, I'm going, God, well, I don't know exactly what I'm in here for. And this woman came through and she started screaming profanity. And she's screaming profanity and everybody was looking at her and said, oh, that's Pauline. Just go shut up. Go sit her and sit down. And she would just walk around aimlessly. And so I looked at her and I felt the Lord say, this is the one. And I mean, she was scary. And she'd sit down. And I went and sat down by her, and she grabbed my hand, and she started trying to read my palm. And I said, "No, you won't do that. You won't do that." And I just sat with her, and I just prayed quietly in tongues, and I just prayed beside her, and she got quieter. And so, over the next month or 2 months, my mission was this woman named Pauline. And I would go in and she'd be screaming or whatever, and I'd just sit beside her. And she wasn't somebody that was coherent that I could really share too much with, but I talked about Jesus and I quietly prayed for her. And there were several other ladies that I kind of reached out to, but this was my assignment from the Lord. So one Sunday, Bill had to work, and I was at church, and we had a great church. And all of a sudden, have you ever just had a, like you have a burden from the Lord in intercessory prayer, a deep burden, and you can't hardly function because you've got to pray it out. And I remember I had gone to the front of the church, and as people were praying, and I was just doubled over, and I was praying, and I was like, I wasn't even sure what I was praying about, but this just sense of a burden, a deep burden. And I remember later we had been fasting, and all of a sudden it just released. And that I met Bill for lunch, and which was a crazy thing for us to do because we've been fasting. We decided to go to Long John Silver's and have tea, have a glass of tea. And I'm thinking, we're fasting for a couple of days and here we're going. But we went and we sat down, and as we're sitting there, I started telling Bill, I said, I don't know what this is about, but just had this burden, and it was released, but I was praying through something. And he said, well, maybe it was for Pauline. And about that time, Bill is looking right over my head, and he goes, but he did it very manly. And I said, what? And I turn around, I'm looking, and right over the top of my head is a picture, a painting of a ship. And underneath is the name of the ship, and the name of the ship is Pauline. And so Bill and I think the following Monday I went in to, and I started looking for her and I couldn't find her. And I said to one of the other women, I said, where's Pauline? And she said, oh, she scratched me and then she died. And I said, what? And she said, no, she died. And she did have a nice scratch mark on her face. And so I went to one of the orderlies, one of the people there. I said, where's Pauline? And they said, oh, Pauline died Sunday morning. They said, but it was the strangest thing because Pauline went into her room and she was calm and she laid on her bed and she began to talk to somebody that was standing beside her, but there was just this peace. I know when I get to heaven, I'm going to see Pauline. At that point, I was released from work or from volunteering this place. The grace was gone. I just knew I wasn't even supposed to go back. God sent me for that woman. And I was the answer to somebody's prayers. I believe that with all of my heart, that someone prayed for that woman. And I believe that when I get to heaven, I'm going to see her there. And we've talked about this, how it's not about, you know, Bill says that, it's not about missions, is wherever you're at, and then you're listening to God. And you're allowing God to use you. Years later, we were in Romania, and with the Romania, what had happened there was there were just so many state-run orphanages. And if you ever saw any of the 60 Minute, they did several documentaries on what had happened in Romania after the fall of communism, and there were thousands and thousands and thousands of abandoned children. And they were housed in these government orphanages that many of them were equipped to hold 200, maybe 200 children, 500 children, and there were thousands of children crammed on top of each other. There were children that had so many different handicaps, and there were mentally handicapped children with children that just had different maybe physical problems, and they were on top of each other, and it was just horrific. And so Bill and I went, and we worked there for several years, and we helped establish a very beautiful orphanage there. And but I remember one time we went to a couple of these different orphanages around our area, and we were like in five different orphanages in 3 days. Or no, in just one day, wasn't it? And so the second one that we went to, we walked in, and I remember as we walked into this room, it was just solid cunas. ¿Cómo es cuna? Cribs. There were cribs there, and the children in that room were about 2 years old and under. And they were all taking a nap, and they opened the door, and I kind of peeked in, and about that time, these children started pulling themselves up on their cribs, and they held out their hands, and they went, "Mama, Mama, Mama," and my heart was just so broken, watching all these little kids. And then we walked down the aisle, and they had given some sort of a medication during that time, where many children had been born without arms, and there's babies in these little these little cribs, and they have no arms. And I remember just almost stumbling out of this place. And as we're walking across to the car, I'm crying, and I'm just saying, "God, where are you in this? Where are you in all of this pain? Where are you in this? What are you doing, God? What are you doing?" And there's the just aching in my heart for what I was seeing. And I remember at that moment how the Lord, I mean, just this thought cuts across. And he said, "Oh, but child, I am doing something. I've sent you. I've sent you." And, you know, there wasn't a whole lot that I could do in that particular situation, but I was doing something. I had been called. Bill and I were called to this place. We were called just to the little bit that we could, maybe a drop in the bucket, but we were, like Bill was talking about yesterday, the Gadarean, for one. Maybe you're not called to multitudes. Maybe you're not called to go on the foreign field. Maybe that is not your calling, and that's just fine, but you are called. You are called to someone. You are called, and it is so important. We get so consumed with sometimes in the Christian world with building a ministry, being a prophet, being a teacher, being a pastor, being a something. I want to tell you the key to it all is death. It is a death to self and living to Christ. It's not about having titles. It's not about having ministries. It's not about having a card with your name on it that says you're a prophet. It's about knowing Jesus Christ and allowing the Lord to so fill your life that you're being directed by him. It is God through you reaching out and holding and comforting. It is God through you reaching out and serving. It is God through you reaching out, mopping the floors and cleaning the toilets. And it is God through you serving. He said, "I did not come to be served, but I came to serve." That is our pattern. This is our God who gave up everything. Jesus, who left the glory of heaven and that was born into the arms of a and held in the arms of a woman. This is our Creator, our God. This is our pattern. And he says, if you want to be my disciple, if you want to be, how many want to be his disciple? If you want to be my disciple, pick up your cross. Pick up your cross and follow me. He didn't tell us, pick up your ministry, pick up your title, pick up a little of my glory. He said, pick up your cross. I have been your example, now follow me. And you know something? You can have a lot of good ideas and even, you know, ideas about service and whatever, but I want to tell you, God blesses his ideas. And that's our responsibility. You know, I look around many times and I think, how did this happen? how, God, how did all of this happen? He's not smart enough. And I know I'm definitely not smart enough. How did all of this beautiful thing happen? And it happened because two people just said, I'm going to throw my life at the feet of Jesus. And whatever he wants to do, wherever he wants to do it, however he wants to do it, here we are. All I want to do, God, is glorify you. Sometimes that feels good and sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes it's exciting and sometimes it's just drudgery. You just have to keep getting up and doing what he told you to do the last time he told you to do something. Sometimes you have amazing feelings and the presence of God is just so all-consuming you think, I can't stand it. And then there are times when you can't feel anything. Sometimes he gives you direction like that. The word opens up and you get revelation and it's like, oh, I can't stand this. And then there's times you read and you think, I don't understand anything I just read. I was just thinking about washing dishes. I mean, sometimes it's just, but what I have found, somebody said one time, they said, Tammy, what do you think the secret is? And it's just death and perseverance. And yes, sometimes there's joy. There's incredible joy. Bill and I have 40-something children, and sometimes it's pretty, well, he used to have a little hair when we got started, but I look at my kids sometimes, and this joy, everybody here, like, have you seen my grandkids? Have you seen my grandkids? Let me tell you something, have you seen my grandkids? No. And I have a child, I have one child, and that she says, she's just as dark, she has beautiful black hair and brown eyes, and just as she's got, her skin is just beautifully brown, and she slides up against me, and she looks at the rest of the kids, and she says, I look like Mom. There's incredible joy in it. I just want to encourage you before we leave today. When you walk out of here, you've been called to somebody. You have been called to do something. Get your antennas out. Get in the Word of God. Let the Lord speak to you. Let him lead you. Let him guide you. Whether it's neighbors or friends, or maybe he'll take you someplace like he did me over several different times of going into a business. Or one time he sent me into a church and I had no idea why I was there. And he said, go pray for the pastor. I didn't know that they had just ran over one of the children in the church. Accidentally, there had been an accident and God sent me because my antennas were out. God wants to send you. He wants to do something amazing through you. Can you hear us? Can you hear us? There's a challenge. Take what you've learned after years and years and years of amazing teaching. Amazing teaching. Take it and put it into practice, because what good is it in a book if you're not using it? What good is it on a cassette or a CD or people can pull it up if you're not using it? It had an hour, call Bill and I every Monday night for years and years, and we talked about the doing, the taking and the doing with it. And I'm telling you, I believe with all my heart that this church has come to, you've been prepared and prepared and prepared. And I know many of you have been doing things. Please, I'm not here to offend you. But there's some that haven't been. And God is saying it is time. The church is going forward. It has been prepared. There is a foundation, a root system in this church that is so deep, so profound. And we need to be thankful for what God has done. But now the Lord is saying, okay, the cloud is moving and we're going in a different direction. Will you come with me? Will you follow me into the next step? Because there is a world that is lost all around you. There are people in pain all around you. and they need what you have. Don't put your light under a bushel. Shine, shine, shine. Be brilliant. Brilliant in your confession of who Jesus Christ is. Live in a way that people are going to hate you or love you, but you will have an effect in their life. Don't be tepid. Don't be lukewarm. Be passionate for the God who saved your life. Be passionate for the one who restored your soul. Be passionate for him who gave it all for you. And do not be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God. Bless your hearts. Go forth and do exploits. People say, it's the end times, it's the end times. And it very well could be the end times, but it's the end time for me. Maybe I have another 20 years. It's my end time, and I'm going to live it with a passion for Jesus. I'm going to live it in a way that is glorious for his name. So it might be the end times, but if not, it's your end time. And this is such a brief thing. Jesus, God said in his word, it's just such a brief time to be alive. It's so brief. Invest it and take the talents that he's given you and invest it fully in his kingdom. God bless you, each and every one of you. It's been a privilege for us the last few days to be with you, to share part of our story. And we tell you again, we are those foolish, the weak that God chose to confound some wise people. Because people look at us down there and they're going, how did they do that? Yeah. Amen.
We invite you to stand with us for this last song. Lord, we dedicate this to you. Thank you, Jesus.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished. The end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Yes, you are God. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages step down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ. The promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion said the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Yeah. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. This salvation.
Big thank offering. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord. Well, thank you for coming and ministering to us. We received that word. We're so grateful. Can we thank the Lord for Bill and Tammy coming this weekend? And prayerfully, we want them back. This is just the beginning. We have a long-standing relationship with Bill and Tammy. Our church supports their ministry. They're one of the ministries. And you know, we don't fundraise. We don't put high-pressure techniques for fundraising. But I just want to let you know, if you want to support their ministry, you can do it through the church and earmark on your check for Lost and Found Ministries or Bill and Tammy, and it'll get to them, okay, if the Lord should put it on your heart. So I just want to make you aware of that. Bill, when you were speaking about Bethany, I felt the Lord speak to my heart. And Bethany is not only a person, it's a place. Bethany means house of suffering or house of poverty. And that's the place that Jesus went to before he went to the cross. You see, he took our suffering. And so God doesn't want you to carry your sorrow. He was a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. But here's the good news. He took it all for you. And the invitation, and it's an invitation, not an ultimatum. God won't push himself on you. He's not going to strong arm you. He's not going to beat you over the head. It's love, and he's extending his arms to anyone here who's never received him. He says, I went to that place of suffering. I went to that place of punishment so you could be completely set free. I'm going to pray a prayer. And if you're ready and you'd like to, if you're online or you're in here, please pray this prayer to receive Jesus. There's three things you need to do. You need to acknowledge that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, died on the cross for your sins and rose from the dead. The second thing you need to say is, I'm not good enough. I cannot earn my salvation. That's only what Jesus did. But the third thing is, you make a choice. I choose to pray to receive him by faith. I turn from trying to live life my way, and I surrender to life his way. If you can agree to those three things, I'm inviting you to pray. But I want you to know, if you're not ready, please don't pray it, because it won't make any difference. I want you to want this, not because you have to, but because this is what you want. But it's available. And I don't want anyone to leave here without at least hearing the good news. So I'm going to pray a prayer, and you can just agree in your heart with me. This is between you and God. This is a holy moment. Dear God, I am a sinner. I can't save myself. I can't fix myself. I can't change my mess. I'm completely broken. Lord, I thank you that you love me enough, that Jesus Christ, your Son, died on the cross for my sins. He shed his blood for me, and he rose from the dead. And this is by grace, and I thank you. I turn from my sin, I turn to you and ask you to forgive my sin, come into my heart, And I want to do this journey with you. For I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you said that prayer, and if there's any way we can encourage you, we'd love to. Please call or email the office, and someone will be happy to connect with you. If you're here this morning and you need prayer, we have a wonderful prayer team. You know, we love to pray for people on any needs, whether you're Christian, non-Christian. You have a need after the service, we will pray for you over here. I'm just going to close in prayer. Thank you for coming. Isn't God good? Let's give the Lord another praise offering. Father, I so thank you for my brother and sister. Thank you for such a great turnout, Lord. Thank you that we have freedom in Christ. And Lord, I ask, Lord, for a real release of your spirit, the things that they came to encourage us. Lord, let us take them to heart and let you speak to each of our hearts how we can serve you. It'll look different than with Bill and Tammy, but it'll look right for each of us. So Lord, this week, may we be changed by the power of Christ. Let people know their identity, that they're loved, that they have purpose, and God can use them no matter what they've done or no matter how bad they've messed up in life. They still have purpose. Where sin abounds, grace much more, and it's in that place of grace, not our own ability, but in your grace, that we do all things through Christ who strengthens us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Glory to God. Have a wonderful week.